Hello, and welcome to episode 41 of Public Interest Podcast with your host, Jordan Cooper, where we interview politicians, activists, advocates, and others who seek to improve the state of the world. We're here today with Chief Manger of Montgomery County's Police Department. How are you doing today, Chief Manger?
I'm well, thank you, Jordan.
Awesome. Great to have you here. The first question I'd like to ask is, what are you currently doing or what have you ever done to advance the public interest and why?
Say that for the last 40 years, I've been a police officer, and I took this job because I wanted to help people, and that's been my mission for the last 40 years. So I could cite you specific examples, but I would just say that my record as a police officer is the best answer to that question.
So you're helping people as a police officer over a long career, and now you're chief of police. How does that differ, helping people as the head of a large department versus just being where you were 20 or more years ago when you started your career?
About 40 years ago. Yeah. That's a great question. And actually, I can recall very early on as a police officer responding to different calls, and I was literally helping people who were either having the worst day of their life or mm-hmm. were severely injured or who were dealing with the worst crisis perhaps that they'd ever dealt with in their life. And I was able to give them the assistance they needed, get them to where they could get treated or, you know, just get the help they needed to start on the road to recovery. Today, as a police chief, mm-hmm. I think with the policies I put in place, with the training that I give my cops, mm-hmm. With the way I deploy my resources, I'm helping our community on a grander scale. Mm-hmm. And hopefully that the decisions I make, the strategies that I put in place are the kind that are impacting the community in a positive way.
So impacting the community on a grander scale. Can you give me an example of what exactly you mentioned? I think you made an oblique reference to an opioid epidemic, and you mentioned someone potentially helping them in terms of saving their life even.
Right.
What are you currently doing? What is your department doing to try to improve the world and advance the public interest?
Well, that's a good example to use. We've been seeing this growth of this opioid epidemic for a few years now. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the police department would respond to these overdoses. You know, we'd work with fire rescue and to get the people the help that they needed. Mm-hmm. And, you know, a lot of folks were taken to the hospital and recovered. But there were a fair number, dozens and dozens of people that died every year in Montgomery County from these heroin overdoses. And so one of the things that we did policy-wise was to adopt a program where we have officers now carrying naloxone, or some people call it Narcan. And I would say two or three times a night, mm-hmm. we respond to, and now I say we, I'm talking about the police and fire rescue, respond to overdose calls where we are giving folks naloxone and they are recovering instantly from their overdose. So this policy decision to arm my police officers with naloxone has really resulted in lives being saved out in our community on a regular basis. So this is, you know, while I'm not the one dispensing the naloxone, the fact that the police department decided to train our officers to do it, mm-hmm. to get the naloxone and adopt this strategy of giving it to folks that were experiencing overdoses has really, I think, had a positive impact. Now, that said, I'll tell you the long-term solution I think are recommendations that may come out of the governor's task force on opioid addiction. Mm-hmm. And my hope is that we get better education, better treatment resources. Mm-hmm. This is not a problem that we're going to police our way out of. I mean, mm-hmm. you know, arresting people is not going to solve the problem. This is a problem that needs to be addressed through treatment, education, and hopefully we can, convince people that not to start using prescription medication or other drugs that might lead to these more severe consequences.
So many people, so there's multiple ways to interact with the police force. Many people will see a police car on the side of a street or a highway, and then you'll also associate police force with dialing 911. However, when someone does dial the emergency hotline 911, often there's a choice between, you know, if I'm having a heart attack, maybe sending a police officer isn't the most appropriate thing, or if my house is burning down, you know. So you mentioned earlier fire and emergency medical services, the ambulance, basically.
Right.
So why would a police department be armed with this tool to help address opioid addiction? Why would the police, why would a policeman even, a police car even be sent to the scene of someone having a medical issue?
Well, we wouldn't necessarily be dispatched, but when, but basically the person who's closest, and sometimes we are dispatched. I mean, sometimes it's typical to get a call from a business who says, hey, there's someone passed out in a bathroom stall.
Uh-huh.
And they'll dispatch the closest, you know, they might dispatch fire rescue and a police officer because they don't know what the situation is.
Mm-hmm.
And if we get there first, we can provide that person the help they need in a more timely fashion. So basically, it all comes down to who can get there first. Sometimes the fire department gets there first, and oftentimes the police department gets there first.
Interesting. So do you coordinate at all with fire and EMS? How does that work? It sounds like your officers are, like, partially trained to do public health measures in addition to enforcing the law.
Well, I would say that what we do in terms of public health is limited to the naloxone. We carry the defibrillators if we come across somebody who's having a heart attack.
Really?
Many officers carry those defibrillators in their car. So we can, for those things, those kinds of things where seconds might make a difference between life and death, you know, we want to have some of those resources out there. But believe me, we have a terrific fire rescue service in Montgomery County, and we're just trying to supplement some of what they do. But we've got enough to keep us busy. We're not trying to take over any of their responsibilities. But it's really a matter of this is a force multiplier. You have more folks that have these resources that can save lives out in the community, and we want to take advantage of that force multiplier.
Now, you mentioned spending upwards of four decades in policing, and correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe you might have had some experience in Northern Virginia and other jurisdictions. Can you speak to me a little bit about what makes Montgomery County special? What is it that's unique about your role in this particular police force?
I did. I spent the first half of my career with the Fairfax County Police, and 13 years ago came to Montgomery County as the police chief. And I can tell you, I've been blessed to work for two very good police departments. But I will tell you that Montgomery County has the same challenges that any other urban jurisdiction has. You know, we are a county of a million people.
Mm-hmm.
We're a county that, despite its reputation for being so affluent and all the great things about this county, the fact is we have pockets of poverty, we have unemployment, we have homelessness, we have the same issues that can be at the root causes of criminal activity. We have gangs here. It's not a huge problem, but we do have them here. So we have all the great things about that people often talk about, you know, Montgomery County having, but we also have our share of crime and activity, you know, in terms of things that keep police busy. So what makes Montgomery County special? I will tell you that it's that we have a public that, first of all, is very supportive of, and believe me, not everybody loves the police, but in general, Montgomery County is very supportive of its police department. We have a great relationship with the community. We spend a lot of time trying to do outreach to every segment of our community, and Montgomery County is unique in some ways. I mean, you know, we I guess we're described now as a majority-minority community. The fact is, you can't say the community and make any generalizations about Montgomery County. We have many, many segments of our community.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, when I go speak at a homeowners association meeting in Bethesda, that what they want to talk about is very different than when I'm at a CASA meeting in Silver Spring. You know, the issues are very different, and what they want to talk to the police about is very different. So we spend a lot of time doing outreach, and this is a very sophisticated community, and it's great to police in a county where the police department is appreciated and supported as much as it is.
Why is it important for the police department to conduct community outreach?
Well, because that's the only way that I think people can feel like they're being heard. And I will tell you that you only need to look around to some jurisdictions, cities around the country to see where the police department and the community do not have a good, trusting relationship. And again, I'm not saying it's perfect in Montgomery County. We always have work to do to improve the trust and confidence that we have with the community. But when you look at what's going on in some other cities around the country, where there's such a disconnect, it seems, between the police and the community, where the community, where, you know, they're having homicides in the community, and nobody will come forward to help the police. No witnesses. Nobody will, you know, will even call the police when a crime occurs. I mean, that is a recipe for you know, a community that has real crime and safety issues. We're blessed here. I mean, you know, yes, there's probably, I know for a fact there's some crime that goes unreported, but it's not the norm. I mean, most of the crime that occurs here, we get great first of all, we get people that will call 911. Secondly, we get people that will come forward and say, hey, I have information, and provide us with information. We have witnesses that come forward and will be willing to testify in court. We have all the, and the only reason we have that is because of the outreach we do and the trust and confidence we've built with the community.
I'd like to return to that topic in a little bit, but right now I'd like to shift the conversation a little bit to you. You know, what is it? Well, first of all, I'm interested in your leadership style. Obviously, Montgomery County hit the news, the national news, pretty hard with a DC Beltway sniper in 2002 under your predecessor. What is it that really every morning you wake up and you, and what's on your mind? What's challenging you? What's your biggest concern? What's driving you every single day?
Well, it's probably not the healthiest motivator, but I actually, every day when I wake up, it's like, okay, what's the worst thing we're dealing with, and how can I improve that? You know, it's funny, I my colleagues will tell me, they say, you know, so many things are going well, we have so much good news, you know, yeah, in terms of the crime rates and all that sort of thing. You know, it's like you don't take time to enjoy that, and I don't. I'm just focused on what needs improving, what's wrong, what needs improving. And so I'm my wife would tell anybody, I'm always a glass half empty kind of person. And I'm not really in life, but I am when I'm at work. It's like, where do we need to improve our efforts? What are the problems we're experiencing? You know, if we've got a segment of the community, or we've got a neighborhood that's not happy about, you know, crime issues or whatever, or not happy about something the police did, that's what occupies my time. That's what that's where I focus my efforts. That's what I worry about every day.
Are you on call 24/7?
I am, and have been for 18 years.
So it must weigh on you to kind of have a glass half empty, always worrying about the biggest crisis without any real respite. If you're always on call as a chief of a large police force and you're always thinking about the worst thing possible, does that ever begin to weigh on a man?
It does. It does. I will tell you, and I'd be lying to say if it didn't. But I have a great family. I have a wonderful wife. I have such great colleagues that I work with, and they do help me share the burden of the things that we need to do. I don't feel like I'm, you know, that I'm just all by myself worrying about these things. I have assistant chiefs that worry as much as I do, that yeah, work as hard as I do. So I know I'm part of a team effort, and I will say that I do allow myself to enjoy small victories.
Do you even go on vacation?
I do go on vacation, but I try not to go far enough away that if something happens, I can't get back
really
quickly. A typical vacation for me is you know, where I'm out, but then something will occur and I'll have to go back to the county. I typically
you're not in Paris, for instance.
No, and if I did, I would have to. I'd make arrangements ahead of time if I was going, because I have gone away a few times, but not very often. Usually my vacations are in a car within a few hours of Montgomery County.
Would you ever encourage your children to go into policing?
You know, I wouldn't encourage them or discourage them. I have two teenagers, and neither one of them has expressed any interest. And in fact, if you talked to either one of them, they and said, would you ever think about being a police officer, they would both give a resounding no. They've got many other interests, and they couldn't tell you what they're going to do, but I would neither discourage them nor encourage them. I think that, for instance, my daughter argues with me, I think she's a natural for law school, and I'm going to encourage her to do that.
Are you the first in your family to join a police force or do law enforcement?
No, law enforcement did not run in my family. I was the first one to be, and so far the only one.
What drew you to it then? I mean, you were a teenager at one point, you went to school, and then You know, you had probably many options, and you're like, well, let me just be concerned about disasters 24/7 for the rest of my life. I mean,
well, I'll tell you, as a young cop, you weren't worried about those that big picture stuff. You were worried about what calls you got dispatched to that day, what you were going to face that day. And believe me, there was as somebody once described being a police officer as having a ringside seat to the greatest show on earth. And I couldn't have said it better. I have had some of the most unbelievable experiences that you can imagine, both good and bad. And so, you know, what drew me to this work was I wanted to help people. And it's funny that when I started in high school and college, I thought, well, you know, and this was right around the time of Watergate, way before your time. But around, and I thought, you know, these two investigative journalists were doing things that were changing this world and righting wrongs, looking for justice in an unjust, you know, situation. And I said I was drawn to that. And so I actually started college majoring in journalism, quickly got disillusioned with that for a number of reasons, and then decided that social work, and I moved from that to I took a criminal justice class and was really hooked on police work ever since.
Interesting. Journalism. I imagine as chief of a large police force, you must interact with the press on a regular basis.
Every day.
So how what are you thinking when you're interacting with the press? Because I'm sure some of the public is going to see you on television or read different reports. Maybe someone's listening who isn't even living in Maryland, but there's always a police force, and they're seeing them on the television, they're seeing press releases, quotes in the press. What are you thinking as you interact with the press, especially with the background about Woodward and Bernstein, who pulled the whole Watergate story for the Post?
Well, I would love to believe that every journalist has their work ethic and their commitment to accuracy. What I've learned is not so much. So you learn to deal with some members of the media who are very committed to accuracy in their reporting. You also learn that you deal with some folks that have an agenda, and they have their story written before they even speak with you.
Huh.
And it's discouraging sometimes, you know, to deal with folks like that. But you know what? They have their job to do. I have my job to do. And their job is not to make me look good. Their job is not to just repeat whatever I want them to say. They have, you know, they need to report the news. And so I get what their job is. I understand it. But again, working with many of the reporters that I've worked with over the years, some of them who are just whip smart, very dedicated to their craft, good writers, and committed to accuracy. That's all I can ask.
So I'd like to shift the topic a little bit to politics. Now, you know, you mentioned yourself wanting to advance the cause of justice, and journalists potentially having that noble calling, although potentially, you know, everything's different in reality. But then, obviously, you have a lot of politicians who also seek to improve the world. And in fact, you come to be in this position because an elected official, County Executive Ike Leggett, appointed you to be the chief of police. And then, of course, you mentioned earlier the Black Lives Matter movement, tensions between police forces and the public and different places around the United States. How is it that you feel your job is affected by politics, whether it's, you know, that you report to a politician who reports to the public, or just how police forces are portrayed by politicians or by the media? How is it that you're part of a wider, grander society that incorporates so many different themes that ripple, especially as policing is becoming on the national forefront in terms of big stories of the day?
Yeah, that's a big question. I'll focus on the one aspect of this. I was actually appointed the police chief here by former county executive Doug Duncan.
Huh.
I was reappointed a few years later by Mr. Leggett when he was elected county executive. So I've actually served under two county executives in the county. You know, a good mayor, a good county executive, a good chief elected official sets out an agenda and can talk about policies and you know, what the goals that they'd like to see. I have been so fortunate, and especially with Mr. Leggett, he never once has told me how to do my job. He selected me to do my job. He has certainly set out expectations, and I know what his goals are and his philosophy is, and he has left me to run the police department. And there's always a host of issues that he and I talk about. He's very engaged in what's going on in terms of crime, in terms of police issues. He's certainly been very supportive of public safety during his tenure as county executive. But I think where you run into problems is where you have mayors and county executives who start trying to tell their police chiefs how to police. And that's where I think politics can sort of get, tangled up with delivering lawful, fair, consistent policing. And, I think what the public should expect is that my cops are performing their job first and foremost lawfully. Secondly, that they are doing it, treating people with dignity and respect, that they are enforcing the law fairly and without bias. And those are noble goals, and that's what we try to do. And to the extent that we can accomplish that, I think that we're policing the way we should be policing. What you don't want is elected officials, politicians come in and say, and I'll use the example of marijuana. They say, we really don't think marijuana is a big deal, so we don't want you enforcing any drug laws. Those kinds of things that, where politics and law enforcement would entangle are not, that never has a good outcome.
So the legislature should make that call. And if they legalize a drug, then you no longer have to enforce a law that doesn't exist. That's what should happen. You're saying if politicians think you shouldn't enforce a certain law, they should change the law.
Exactly.
And then you'd be happy to enforce that law.
Right. What we don't want is for uneven enforcement, because this politician is really worried about,
speeding, for instance, on the highways.
Right.
Everyone goes above 55 miles an hour on the highway,
right.
So everyone breaks the law, and there's cognitive dissonance in the minds of law-abiding citizens. How do you tackle that?
Well, I think you try and use a little bit of common sense. I mean, first of all, I don't know of anyone. I'm sure there's someone, one of your listeners will say, it happened to me. But, the speed limit's 55 on the Beltway. We're not stopping people for going 56 and giving them a citation. If somebody's going 10, wait till at least they're going 10 over before you might stop them. And on the Beltway...
Does that frustrate you? Legislature should push the speed limit higher?
I don't even get involved in that. I think that I understand why speed limits are set by road engineers. I understand why, they lower it to 55 versus a road that was designed to be 65 or 70.
Mm-hmm.
I get all that. And you know what? Whatever decision that the policymakers make is fine.
Mm-hmm.
Then I know what my job is. The last thing you want, I think, is to have a police chief making decisions about what a speed limit should be, about what a law should be,
mm-hmm.
all those kinds of things. I enforce the law. I don't want to make it. I want to enforce the law, and I want to do it fairly, consistently, and without bias.
We're nearing the end of the podcast, so I'd like to ask you a last question and allow you some leniency to go wherever you want on this question. You feed into the criminal justice system. You are part of a national dialogue on policing. You have relationships necessarily with legislators and with community members. You have so many different things pulling you. You are limited in where you can personally vacation. You always, if you're having fun playing golf or going out to dinner with your family and you're in some emergency, then you need to go, and you give a lot, you deal with a lot, all right? Why? What is your motivation? You said you want to help people, but you mentioned there are other ways to help people that might, be less burdensome potentially. Why is it that you put yourself, that you've made a career of public service through law enforcement?
I love what I do. I've been a cop for 40 years. I really feel fulfilled personally and professionally because of what I do. I remember very vividly having a conversation with my wife one night. We were having dinner, and I was just sort of downloading my day, of all the things I did. And she said to me, she says, I really envy you. And I said, well, what do you mean? She says, because you really do something. She says, you make a difference in people's lives. And, I mean, I sort of knew that, but, it, I mean, it really, you know, sort of struck home when she pointed that out, because here I'd been sort of downloading my day, half sort of venting and, you know, saying, oh, gosh, and then this happened. And the way she saw it was, well, you just spent your day trying to, you know, make, you know, help people. So I do like doing what I'm doing. I love being a cop. Listen, I have bad days. There are days when things don't go the way I would like them to, that are frustrating. I've lost track of the number of sleepless nights I've had because of the difficulties of this job. But I still have a few miles left in the tank. I've been doing this for 40 years. The average tenure for a police chief in the United States of America is 3 to 4 years. I've been a police chief for 18, 6 in Fairfax, 13 here. That's 19, isn't it? Okay, 19 years, yeah. So I have a few miles left in the tank. Mr. Leggett's been terrific to work for, and he's got a few more years in office, a couple more years. I'd certainly like to work through his term, and then we'll see who the next county executive is, and we'll see what's in store for me then.
So Chief Tom Manger of Montgomery County Police Department talks about a lifetime of service because he really just wants to help people, driven by justice, rewarded by excitement, being on the front page of history, feeling the inherent reward of making a difference every day. It's exciting, it's meaningful, but most importantly, he brings passion to the job, and he makes a great deal of difference, evidently, in his many policies with his police force and the million-person population he polices. But generally, he finds it personally fulfilling, and for him, that is a career well made. Thank you so much for joining us for episode 41 of Public Interest Podcast with your host, Jordan Cooper, where we interview politicians, activists, advocates, and others who seek to improve the state of the world. Thanks so much for joining us, and we'll talk to you next time.